Are you coming to the tree where they strung up a man? They say murder three.
Nope, not this time.
I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. Don't want a doll, no dinky tinker toy. I want a hippopotamus to play with and enjoy. I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. I don't think Santa Claus will mind you. He won't have to use our dirty chimney flue. Just bring him through the front door, that's the easy thing to do. I can see me now on Christmas morning creeping down the stairs. Oh, what joy and what surprise when I open up my eyes to see a hippo hero standing there. I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. No crocodiles, no rhinoceroses. I only like hippopotamuses, and hippopotamuses like me too.
Okay, that is one long song by Gail Peavy. We play it each and every year for the Christmas show. And each and every year I get a nasty gram from YouTube telling me that I can't make any money using that song. And I have to explain to them that I have yet to make any money doing the podcast, but oh well, that's life. Welcome to the show. This is Strange Things with Chris James. And tonight joining me is my wife, Lulu.
Hi, welcome.
This will be our fourth Christmas show, and I'm still finding things to talk about, so I guess I'll just hopefully never run out of things to say about Christmas. The other day, I got one of those thoughts that follow me around all day. Where does Santa get his money? You know, he has bills, electricity, water, gas, things like that. So I voiced my question to my wife so she could think about it all day as well. After a bit, Lulu said she thought that maybe Santa got his money from making all those toys, but then he gives them all away. So that couldn't have been the answer. So then she said,
maybe he makes money from all those Coke advertisements.
Yeah, you see Santa Claus drinking a Coke all the time, and that got me to thinking, what if he owns Coke? After all, that's where you see him most of the time. However he does it, he does pay his bills because he's still out there flying around the world. Tonight, we're going to be reading some stories, Santa-themed or Christmas-themed, one of the two. And we'll be telling you a few things that you might not want to know, but I find interesting. You want to give us that first one?
Okay. The first one is Dave Grinstead told this story at Christmas time in 1961. Our family was on the way from Seattle to a new assignment on the East Coast. As we checked into a motel in Watertown, South Dakota, it was not the best time to travel with young children, who were concerned about Santa finding us on the road. We headed into town to find a store, and as our car approached the intersection, there was a Santa right on the crosswalk. He held up his hand for us to stop, and we rolled down our windows. Santa poked his head through a window and said to our kids, "Oh, there you are. I was wondering where I was going to find you tonight." Naturally, the kids were thrilled to pieces. They made sure we told Santa which motel we were staying and so he could find them. My wife and I had tucked away gifts for the trip as we knew we wouldn't have time to shop along the way. The car top carrier and out-of-state license plate might have been a giveaway, but whatever it was, that Santa really made Christmas 1961 a memorable one for our kids.
Sometimes people really get into the spirit of Christmas, and I'd like to tell people it's not all about gift-giving and receiving. There's nice things you can do for people other than spend money on them.
That was a very sweet story.
Mm-hmm. Most of us have panicked at the prospect of losing a pet, as in they disappear. Whether it's a dog or a cat or even your favorite turtle. Ashley Power from Spruce Grove, Alberta, was unfortunate enough to lose her dog, Frankie. And she said, "It was horrible. I was in disbelief." And she remained in that horror for 5 whole months as she sent flyers hundreds of miles away in hope of being reunited with her pet. Just about as she was giving up all hope of finding him, she received a call from Langley Animal Protection Society. It turned out they had found Frankie running around Abbotsford, British Columbia. Leave it to the Canadians to have names like that, which is over 600 miles away. Power didn't have the means to put Frankie on a flight and get him back home, so the folks at LAPS got help from a truck driver who agreed to return the dog for the distance of 600 miles. That's the reason I am doing this. He livened right up, and was all over her, the driver said after delivering Frankie back to Power. Ecstatic to have her dog back just before the holidays, she told an interviewer that it was a true Christmas miracle. What I'm wondering is how her dog managed to travel 600 miles in the time it was gone. All I can think of is somebody took Frankie, as in stole him, and then the dog somehow managed to escape. You want to tell the folks about our Christmas tradition with the ornaments?
Okay. In our house, we have a tradition that every year we get an ornament that has to do with that year, something that happened in that year. And some of the ones that I remember is we have the flying saucer that was in 2011 when we had a UFO conference in
Laredo.
In Laredo. And
Travis Walton came.
Uh-huh. And he signed that ornament exactly how many years?
29 years to the hour.
When he was abducted. So that's very special for Chris.
Uh-huh.
And we have
The little RV.
The little RV from our first camping trip. And he actually looks like our RV.
Uh-huh.
And we have this year. Which other one we have from previous years?
The Geico. Gecko. Oh, yeah. We really did.
We really did save a lot of money by switching. Mm. Okay.
And it was hump day. No.
No, but yeah, we actually have the Geico.
Uh-huh. And we did save. Anyway.
Okay. Well, anyway, this year we have an ark, as in Noah's Ark. And we went to Kentucky, and we visit. Somebody actually built an ark from all the measurements and things in the Bible, and it's actually worth the trip to go.
Indeed.
We really enjoyed it, and we got a little ark, and that's hanging from our tree this year.
People might not think it's the kind of thing they'd want to see until they actually go there and see it. It will really impress the heck out of you. You stand, well, this is, of course, if you're a religious person. You don't have to be Christian. There were lots of people there from other religions. But to think that one family, Noah and his sons and They probably had a few servants that built this ginormous craft by hand. Now, this is back when you didn't have cranes, you didn't have saws, so everything had to be done by hand. And then, of course, all the animals that they rounded up. It was worth seeing, really. It probably helped a lot that it rained like mad on the drive up there.
Yes, as we were entering the Ark, it was raining. So we were there running around to get to the Ark with our umbrellas.
Don't close the door.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Each year at Thanksgiving, we get together at one of our sister-in-law's houses, my wife's sister's, and we pass around a little plastic container, and everybody picks a name out of there, and then whoever that is, that's who you buy the big gift for. That way you don't get stuck having to buy 10 presents and going into debt up to your eyeballs. On December 23rd, residents of Oaxaca City celebrate the Night of the Radishes. Yes, that's radishes, those little round red things. Locals compete with one another to create the best radish-based display, carving the vegetables into all manner of creative works. The tradition was a clever means of luring consumers to the local Christmas market. The event proved so popular that in 1897, the city's mayor made the Night of the Radishes an official recognized event. The radish exhibitions go through adjudication each year, and the winner is awarded 12,000 pesos. Now, yes, I know pesos not worth that much against the American dollar, but if you're living in Oaxaca, where everything is paid for with pesos, that's a pretty good amount of money. Mm-hmm. Mexican artists craft a variety of displays, carving radishes into nativity scenes, festive characters, animals, monsters, and popular folklore icons. The locals even display these elaborate works of art in a Yuletide decoration around the home. Finally, somebody has come up with a use for radishes. I am not a fan. If I have radishes in my salad, I eat around them, and when I'm done, there's a bowl of radishes in front of me, but that's my thing. I don't know why, I just never developed a taste.
I like them.
I've noticed, but you like liver. And you eat fish and barbacoa.
And you don't like those.
Mm-mm. Hmm. I'm already getting tired of tamales. Living in Laredo, it's the Christmas, New Year's, Thanksgiving. Anytime from November till the middle of January, you're going to have tamales. And you're going to have people knocking on the door during the day selling tamales. And you're going to have people showing up at the workplace selling tamales. And I like the ones that Miss Cortez's sister makes. Believe it or not, they have raisins in them. If you've never had raisins in a tamale, you're missing something. Anyway.
They're good.
It's time for another Christmas story. Now, this one is from Suzanne Cravens. It was in 1999. A few days after Christmas, a black dog with little white around his mouth wandered up onto the front porch and settled in as if he'd lived there his entire life. Kind of reminds me how we got Mark. Whenever anybody left the house to do chores or walk next door, the dog would follow them, as if he lived there his whole time. He'd patiently wait until the visit was done, and then he'd follow the family member back home and lie back down on the porch. Everybody in the house was feeling sad because the 91-year-old father-in-law, Jim Cravens, was very sick. The family had gathered to see to his care and to cook and clean and be there in his last few days. Jim and his wife Dorothy were the beloved pillars of the community, which I'm wondering, who is the pillar of our community? The Sarones, maybe? I don't think it's us. I'd hate to think that it was us. I mean, we do get along and we're in good shape financially and physically, but I don't know if that's what qualifies you as being a pillar. Who do you think the pillar of the community would be if you had to pick?
I don't know.
Can't come up with any ideas. Anyway, this couple was the pillar of the community. The curious visitor, the black dog, gave the family something to talk about. It was a distraction. They would ask whose dog was he, and did somebody drop him off along the road, which unfortunately happens a lot. And they wondered if the dog was going to stay. Either way, it would be dark soon, and he would get cold, and so Jim sat in the rocking chair by the front window where he could watch the happy black dog coming and going. He called the radio station, animal shelter, newspapers, the sheriff, and several neighboring farms about this dog. Meanwhile, the family made the dog comfortable on the porch, giving him food and water and a blanket to lay on. The days leading up to New Year's brought no news, and they were all content that the new member of the family was going to stay. The father-in-law said he wanted to live long enough to see the new millennium, and he did. He passed away January 2nd. The same day, the black dog got up and left. Well, then the weather turned cold and snow fell every day for the rest of the winter. Sometime later, the family heard that the black dog was actually living with a family about a mile and a half from the farm. They had named him Bogart, like as in Humphrey Bogart. The following summer, Bogart returned to see the family once again. When his owners came to pick him up, the two families got to talking about Bogart and how his visit from Christmas to New Year's had helped the family with his cheerful companionship. They wanted to let the new family know how much that had meant to them. Here is another one of our traditions here at our house. Each year, we pick the ornament that means something. We talked about that earlier. Mm-hmm. And
but we forgot to say about the one for 2016.
Yes.
It's a little microphone from the first podcast.
Indeed. I may have mentioned this in the past. I never intended on doing a podcast. When I retired, I was going to sit on the couch. I was going to watch TV. I was going to read my book collection, which I've got thousands of. And I wasn't going to do anything stressful. Well, I have yet to sit on the couch very much and watch very much TV. If I worked this hard when I was an agent, I would have been employee of the month, every month. Arturo Castro, the man that owned the radio station, conned me into doing the podcast. And I've been doing it now for almost 4 years. And so we've got a little microphone hangs on our Christmas tree. The Christmas pickle is perhaps one of the strangest things to adorn any American's tinsel-laden tree. Typically, the glass pickle must be hidden somewhere amongst the tree's branches. You can tell these people don't have cats. Children are then tasked with hunting for the pickle, which is green, so it blends in with the tree very well. Presents are awarded to the first person who finds the pickle, and they receive good fortune for the rest of the year. The exact origins of this rare tradition are uncertain, but several theories have come to light. One says that its origins are from Germany. However, the people in Germany have never heard of this weird decoration. Another theory involves John Lower, an infantryman who enlisted during the Civil War. The story goes that Private Lower was captured and taken to Camp Sumter, caught by the Confederate Army. On Christmas Eve, Lower had begged one of the camp guards for a pickle, which if I was starving, I would ask for Whataburger or Chick-fil-A. Okay, they didn't exist back then, but I sure the heck wouldn't have asked for a pickle. Well, another story is that a glass pickle ornament would be hidden inside the Victorian Christmas tree for good luck. On Christmas Day, the person that found the glass pickle was either given a special gift or allowed to open their present first. That's kind of how we do things in our family. Somebody passes out the presents, and whoever gets the present first, well, they tear into it. It is said that the tradition of the glass pickle originated from the medieval story of two Spanish boys traveling home for Christmas. Now, some of these old stories are really weird. On their way home, they were tired and they decided to stop off at an inn for the night. Well, the innkeeper, being an evil man, stole everything the boys had and then stuffed them into a pickle barrel. Lucky for the boys, Saint Nicholas stopped by the inn and he saved their lives. The boys thanked Saint Nicholas for saving their lives and they continued the tradition to today. Then there's the story, which offers a really different change on it. Three Spanish boys are kidnapped by an evil shopkeeper who chops them up and pickles them. Wonder what he's going to do with pickled humans. Upon hearing about the poor boys, Saint Nicholas prayed to God, and because of his piety and faith, he was successful in restoring the lives to the three boys. Kind of sounds like one of the Grimm's fairy tales, which a lot of people don't know. Those were not children's stories. Anyway, you get to choose which one you like. The thing is, I've never heard of the Christmas pickle until this year. If you watched A Christmas Story, the original one with Darren McGavin, it was narrated by Gene Shepherd, they waited until the night before Christmas to go buy their tree. We usually put ours up December 1st. Well, this year we put it up in November because we were going to be out of town at my cousin's anniversary. It was common practice to wait until just about before the big event to put up the tree as well as the lights and other decorations. You want to tell the next story?
Okay. Gertrude Albert passed on this next story. During the hustle and bustle of Christmas time in 1958, they told their children, ages 3 and 4, about the beautiful Christmas tree they would have in a few days. On Christmas Eve, at the bakery they had recently purchased, the family counted the receipts, cleaned up the shop, and headed for home with their two sleepy children. That was when they remembered they had not been able to get a tree yet. As they drove along the town, they looked for a vendor who might have a tree left. They didn't see anyone selling trees. About a mile from home, they stopped for a red light. Suddenly, a gust of wind blew, and something hit the front of the truck. The husband went out to investigate. The next thing the mother knew, her husband was throwing a good-sized evergreen into the back of the truck. He looked around to see where the tree had come from. It had to have been blown from some tree lot somewhere. He went into the mom-and-pop shop at the corner and asked the proprietor how much was for the tree. The man in the store said he wasn't selling Christmas trees that year. The family took the tree home and decorated it for Christmas. For weeks after, they looked around town trying to find out where the tree had mysteriously come from. They never did find out how the tree came from or how it got to the middle of the road.
Strange things. We've all been in a place in our lives when things were not going well. At the very least, we have seen friends or loved ones in that tough spot. It's truly awful when someone hits a rough patch and can't provide for a family, especially a family with kids. Well, that's where Rosa Cardenas de Reyes was during Christmas of 2011. Since her husband had been unemployed for a stretch of time and they couldn't afford a real Christmas, she did decide to continue with a family tradition of sending letters to Santa by way of balloon. She had her daughter write the letter about what she wanted for Christmas and then launch it into the sky as her daughter waved goodbye to the balloon. Well, as it turns out, the letter knew right where to go. It landed in Northern California. The paper came down on a ranch belonging to Lane Sanderson. He'd been riding across his property on an ATV with his son when they spotted the letter. They had to have a ranch hand translate the letter since it was in Spanish. Sanderson decided maybe he should do something. He contacted the Reyes family and he informed Rosa that they would fund they had found the letter. Lane's wife, Julie, went out with her own daughter to pick out clothes and a doll before sending the items via express to the Reyes family. Too many people get self-centered for Christmas. What did Santa bring me? Now, folks should take a few minutes to think about those who don't have enough or anything. Maybe box up some of last year's Christmas things and give them to the Salvation Army. Now, soon after beginning his ministerial career in England in 1852, William Booth abandoned the concept of the traditional church pulpit in favor of taking the gospel of Jesus Christ directly to the people. Walking the streets of London, he preached to the poor, the homeless, the hungry, and the destitute. When fellow clergymen disagreed with Booth's unconventional approach, he and his wife Catherine withdrew from the church to train evangelists throughout England. The couple returned to the East End of London in 1865, where many followers joined their fight for the souls of lost men and women. Within 10 years, their organization operated under the name The Christian Mission, and they had over 1,000 volunteers and evangelists. They had thieves and prostitutes, gamblers and drunkards who were among their first converts to Christianity. As soon as these converts were also preaching and singing in the streets as living testimonies to the power of God. Booth read a printer's proof of the 1878 Christian Mission Annual Report, and he noticed the statement, "The Christian Mission is a volunteer army." Crossing out the words "volunteer army," he penned in "Salvation Army." From those words came the basis of the foundation of the Salvation Army. From that point onward, converts became soldiers of Christ and were known then as now as Salvationists, which is better than resurrectionists, but that was a different story. They launched an offensive throughout the British Isles that, in spite of violence and persecution, they converted 250,000 Christians between 1881 and 1885. Their message spread rapidly, gaining a foothold in America and soon into Canada, Australia, France, Switzerland, India, South Africa, Iceland, and Germany. They had some colorful members. Though often considered a rude and even obnoxious rule breaker, Joe the Turk opened many important doors for Salvationists across America. With an inherent passion for protecting the prosecuted, he eventually traded in his drinking and smoking habits for a life as a Christian, where he went on to serve as a spirited captain in the Salvation Army until 1925. Famous for his colorful ministry and attention-getting antics, Joe was often jailed for Jesus, as he became known as the spiritual father to thousands of formerly lost souls. Today, the Salvation Army is active in virtually every corner of the world and serves in over 100 countries, offering the message of God's healing and hope to all those in need. When you give money to some charities, most of that money goes towards administrative fees, as in as much as 90%. Some charities don't even bother giving out any of the money they received. The Salvation Army uses about 85% for those in need. Now, that's on a good day. If things get bad, they have been known to put in 100% into charity work and pull money out of the front office as well. The president and CEO of the United Way earns $1.2 million a year. That takes a lot of donations just to pay his upkeep. The president of the Salvation Army gets about $64,000 a year, which is a good income, but he ain't getting rich at that price. I would ask my wife to read this next one, but I don't think she would do it.
No.
The Germans take their naughty and nice list stuff to a new level. December 5th, German children leave a boot outside the front doorway in preparation for St. Nicholas Day. St. Nicholas then checks his golden book for names of nice children. Good children will discover presents, candy, and chocolate inside their boots. Naughty kids, who appear in the black book, receive a bunch of twigs to be used by their parents to pound the nasty out of them, if they're lucky. If not, they just might get visited by Necht Ruprecht. We know him as Krampus. In other parts of Europe, like Austria and the Czech Republic, St. Nicholas's counterpart is more commonly known as Krampus. A Krampus is a half-goat, half-demon creature that is featured in intimidating sets of horns. During parades, adults dress up as the hooved creature and even bind themselves in chains. They chase delinquent kids through the streets with bundles of birch branches. A Krampus is said to drag captured kids off to his lair, where they're going to be the guest of honor for dinner. Yeesh. Krampus stems from the Germanic paganism and Norse mythology. The fearsome creature is thought to be the son of Hel, goddess of the underworld. A bizarre fusion of Christianity and the aforementioned traditions led to Krampus Festival. In Europe, they celebrate St. Nicholas's Day, December 6th, and Krampus Night is December 5th. So, at one time, being on the naughty list meant you might not live to see Christmas.
Yeah.
You want to tell the folks about the candy cane?
Okay. Well, the story that I heard is that candy man maker decided one day that he wanted to make a candy that would honor Jesus and bring more of the Jesus meaning into Christmas. So he made the little candy cane because if you hold it up, it looks like a staff that a shepherd would use, and Jesus is the shepherd, the good shepherd. But if you turn it upside down, is the J for Jesus. Then it has red stripes, which represent the blood that he shed for us. and the white is the purity. Then if you notice, it has a white band, and then it has three tiny little bands that go around the candy cane. I hadn't noticed that until I read the story before. And the three little lines that are very thin represent the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hmm. Getting away from the candy cane, the Yule Cat. A lot of people think cats are evil. Well, this will help them think so. I'm not even going to try to pronounce his name. I'll spell it for you, and you can pronounce it inside your own head. It is Jolakottrinn. They say that Icelandic is the hardest language on the planet to learn. Even old Icelandic people can barely pronounce these words. I think they must hate talking. Anyway, the Yule Cat is an Icelandic folktale monster that preys on poorly dressed people. The bloodthirsty feline eats people who can't afford new clothes in the run-up to Christmas. It is thought that the tale was designed to frighten locals into frenzied work ethics. The slackers, who didn't have the money to pay for new clothes, well, they suffered the attentions of the Yule Cat. The Yule Cat's watchful gaze on children in their homes, checking to see what kind of gifts the kids had earned. Doesn't that sound kind of like Santa? He watches you when you're sleeping. That's a little creepy. Anyway, badly behaved children do not receive clothes from their parents. The punishment? Well, they are summarily executed at the hands of the Yule Cat. Now, isn't that just add a little spark to the whole Christmas story?
But children wouldn't be disappointed to get clothes for Christmas.
True. Those socks would look a lot better.
Like, yay, I got new clothes.
If the horror of the Yule Cat wasn't enough, there's also other characters that went along with the Yule Cat. He's accompanied by the giant mountain-dwelling Gryla and her Yule men. Gryla hunts down naughty kids and hurls them into the stew. Okay, here we go with cannibalism again. Meanwhile, the Yule men pilfer food, terrify wrongdoers, and deposit rotting potatoes on the windowsills of deviant children. Who's going to wake up with a rotting potato on their windowsill after Christmas, I wonder? During the 18th century, the tales of the Yule men became so morbid that the Danish ruling class of Iceland forbade citizens from recounting them. There were originally 50 Yule men, but over the years their number was dwindled down to 13. Their temperament shifted as well. They kind of became akin to mini Santas as the legend began to soften. They started delivering presents to good children instead of messing with the bad ones. The 13 days before Christmas, an Icelandic child places a single boot on their windowsill. The Yule men then deliver gifts on each of the 13 nights leading up to Christmas Day. They still have to contend with the cat, though. I find Christmas cards a bit of a pain, especially nowadays. You have to mail them and then trust the post office to deliver them sometime this year. The stamps have gone up a bit since I was young. I remember 5-cent stamps. Now it costs 50 cents to send each card. It's not that I don't think you're worth 50 cents. It's that I don't want to spend 500 bucks on all the folks my wife knows. Really, we'd probably have to take a loan out at the bank just to pay the postage. The Victorian era is responsible for the creation of the very first Christmas card, which was designed by John Calcott Horsley, an English printer, after being requested by his wealthy friend, Sir Henry Cole. Cole initially came up with the idea for a Christmas card after he realized that he was much too busy to write an individual Christmas greeting to each and every person among his family, friends, and colleagues. Cole was sure that a card with a festive image and a greeting would be a far quicker way to send his holiday wishes to everybody. After its initial success among Cole's friends, thousands of new Christmas cards were printed and put on sale in 1843. However, the Christmas card was not successful at first and was even disapproved by the temperance movement, which feared that the presence of booze in several of the original card designs would encourage drunkenness. As if we need to encourage drunkenness. Let's face it, drunkenness is going to happen. Just look at Prohibition. Nevertheless, a year later, Christmas cards became very popular, and soon their designs varied enormously, thanks to various painters that had different visions for the ideal Christmas card. Like Victorian Valentines, some of these new Christmas card designs featured cherubs and flowers and other symbols of spring and new life. Others, however, were a bit creepier and included strange images of sinister clowns poking policemen with red pokers and giant killer wasps chasing children and gambling monkeys. Now, I'd consider sending out Christmas cards with gambling monkeys on them. One year I did send out some seasoned greetings cards, but, well, I better not talk about that. Would you like to read the next one?
Okay.
Okay. Government being what it is, a bunch of people that think they know how everyone else should live, they've passed some laws when it comes to celebrating Christmas. Back in 1643, England passed an ordinance encouraging citizens to treat Christmas as a solemn holiday. Remember the story about celebrate life? Rather than a celebratory feast. At one time, Christmas was a drunken party where people drank until they passed out all over town. By 1644, Christmas had been banned altogether. Yeah, leave it to the English. Christmas remained illegal in England until 1660, which was the year after Massachusetts banned Christmas. That was back when the colonies were still colonies. In 2016, in Knightstown, Indiana, it became illegal to have a cross on top of a Christmas tree in a public display. They said, the cross is not a Christmas symbol.
Mm-hmm.
The cross is the preeminent symbol of Christianity, and it reminds Christians not of the secular trappings of Christmas, but of the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. Christmas? Christ's Mass? I don't think the folks in Knightstown understand what Christmas is all about. After all, you don't see you do have atheists celebrating Christmas, but they yell, Happy Holidays. No, it's not Happy Holidays, it's Merry Christmas. Anyway, you want to catch the next one?
Okay. In Michigan, these are some of also
weird laws.
Mm-hmm. In Michigan, if you like having a freshly cut Christmas tree, you need to be prepared with your receipt because it is illegal for anyone to transport a Christmas tree without having proof that you bought it. I think...
Nannies.
They're just trying to make sure that you pay for it, I think. I don't know.
I think what was happening is people were going out in the woods and cutting down their own trees, and it's like, oh my God, people are cutting down trees.
Well, I don't know. That's another one. In Nebraska, in 2018, an elementary school principal banned candy canes in school because historically the shape of the candy cane, like I said before, is a J for Jesus. The red is for the blood of Christ, and the white is a symbol of his resurrection. Also, ban anything suggestive of the religious holiday of Christmas, including reindeer, elf on the shelf, and anything red or green.
What do I have to say? And Christmas is Jesus Christ. Come on, people. This is like trying to say that Halloween isn't the time for scary movies. Oh, that has already been suggested as well. Many states and municipalities in the United States have laws regulating how long you're allowed to keep your Christmas lights up after Christmas. In San Diego, you have until February 2nd. Anyone with their lights still up after that faces a fine of up to $250. In Maine, fines may be leveled any time after January 15th. What if those lights are actually Halloween lights? How about you decided to decorate early for Christmas, like, say, in January? I saw Christmas lights up in our neighborhood the 1st of November, so it could happen. Your Christmas lights can be guilty of trespass under light trespass laws, which prohibit such things as misdirected or excessive artificial light caused by inappropriate or misaligned lights that produce unnecessary glowing. New Jersey, in particular, is known for its light trespass laws. Did you know it's against the law to water your neighbor's lawn? Yes, that's the law. Anyway, the lights from our neighbor's tree light up our front yard. You know, I don't care, and neither does my wife.
No.
I say people need to find something more important to outlaw, like driving like an idiot. How about passing a law against robocalls? I get about 10 or 15 a day from folks trying to sell me a new roof, new windows, health care, extended warranty on our vehicles, you name it. Oh yes, and Google calls about 3 or 4 times a day wanting to know why we're not taking full benefit of Google Ads, which I don't see how we could take benefit from them, but oh well. So now the government is concerned about Christmas lights. I've noticed most of these bizarre anti-Christmas laws are up north. Makes me wonder, is it living up where it freezes that's causing people to lose their Christmas spirit? But wait, Santa lives in the North Pole, so it's got to be something else. You want to read the next story?
Okay. This is a real Christmas story, and it's considered a Christmas miracle that happened in December of 1997 in Wisconsin. A little boy and his grandmother came to see Santa at the Mayfair Mall in Wisconsin. The child climbed up on Santa's lap and handed him a photo of a little girl. "Who's this?" asked Santa, smiling. "Your friend? Your sister?" "Yes, Santa," the young boy replied. "That's my sister, Sarah, who is very sick." Santa glanced over at the grandmother, who was waiting nearby, and saw her dabbing her eyes with a tissue. Santa was feeling a bit uneasy. The young boy said, "She wanted to come with me to see you. Oh, so very much, Santa." He then said, "She misses you." Santa tried to be cheerful and encouraged a smile to the boy's face, asking him what he wanted Santa to bring him for Christmas. When they finished their visit, the grandmother came over to help the child off his lap and started to say something to Santa, but halted. "What is it?" Santa asked warmly. "Well, I know it's really too much to ask you, Santa, but..." The older woman pushed her grandson over to Santa's elves to collect the little gift that Santa will give to all the young visitors. The girl in the photograph, my granddaughter, well, you see, she has leukemia and isn't expected to make it even through the holidays. The grandmother said through her tear-filled eyes. She then asked, is there any way, Santa, any possible way that you could come see Sarah? That's all she asked for Christmas. She just wants to see Santa. Santa blinked and swallowed hard and told the woman to leave information with his elves as to where Sarah was, and he would see what he could do. Santa thought of little else the rest of that afternoon. He knew what he had to do. What if it were my child lying in that hospital bed dying? He thought with a sinking heart. This is the least I can do. When Santa finished visiting with all the boys and girls that evening, he retrieved the name of the hospital where Sarah was staying. He asked his assistant, Rick, how to get the children to the children's hospital. Why? Rick asked, with a puzzled look on his face. Santa related to him the conversation with Sarah's grandmother earlier that day. Come on, I'll take you there, Rick said. Rick drove to the hospital and came inside with Santa. They found out which room Sarah was in. A pale Rick said he would wait out in the hall. See, kids have that effect on people. Mm-hmm. Santa quietly peeked into the room through the half-closed door and saw Sarah in the bed. The room was full of what appeared to be her family. There was the grandmother and the girl's brother he had met earlier that day. A woman who he guessed was Sarah's mother stood by the bed, gently pushing what was left of Sarah's hair off her forehead. And another woman, who he later discovered was Sarah's aunt, sat in a chair near the bed with a weary, sad look on her face. They were talking quietly, and Sarah could sense the warmth and closeness of the family and their love and concern for Sarah. Taking a deep breath and forcing a smile on his face, Santa entered the room, blowing a hearty, "Ho, ho, ho!" "Santa!" shrieked Sarah weakly as she tried to sit up in bed. Santa rushed to her side and gave her a warm hug. A child the same age as his own 9-year-old son. Her skin was pale, and her hair showed telltale bald patches from the effects of the chemotherapy. All he saw when he looked at her was a pair of huge blue eyes. His heart melted as he had to force himself to choke back the tears. Santa isn't supposed to cry or get mad or curse or do anything bad. Though his eyes were riveted upon Sarah's face, he could hear the gasp and quiet sobbing of the women in the room. Each member of the family thanked Santa for taking the time to visit their family member, who they all figured wasn't going to make it into the new year. Santa and Sarah talked as she told him excitedly all the toys she wanted for Christmas, assuring him she'd been a very good girl that year. Well, yeah, like it says here, it's kind of hard to misbehave when you're dying. As their time together dwindled, Santa felt as if there was just one thing he could do. He wanted to pray for Sarah. He asked for permission from the girl's mother. She nodded in agreement, and the entire family circled around Sarah's bed holding hands. Then Santa told Sarah, "I am going to ask the angels to watch over you." Laying one hand on the child's forehead, Santa closed his eyes and prayed. He asked that God touch Sarah and heal her body from this disease. He asked that angels to watch over her and then sang Silent Night along with the whole family. Once the song was finished, Santa said, "Now, Sarah, you have a job to do, and that is to concentrate on getting well. I want you to have fun playing with your friends this coming summer. And I expect to see you at my house in Mayfair Mall at this time next year." He knew this was a risky thing to say, but there is something to say for giving people hope. As long as you have hope, you have a chance. Out in the hall, the minute Santa's eyes met Rick's, a look passed between them and they began to cry. They both knew the future wasn't very bright for Sarah. Sarah's mother and grandmother came out of the room and thanked Santa for his visit. He said it was the least that he could do. Santa went on to doing all the things that Santa does, waiting for December.
Well, I wonder if they celebrate Halloween at the North Pole. That's what I was wondering.
Maybe, you know, the Nightmare Before Christmas. But then 1 year later, Santa was once again back at the seat in the Milwaukee at that mall for his seasonal job. Several weeks went by, and when one day a child came up to sit on his lap. "Hi, Santa, remember me?" "Of course I do," Santa proclaimed, as he always do with all the children. And all of a sudden, the little girl said, "Remember, you visited me at the hospital last year." Santa's jaw dropped. Tears immediately sprang into his eyes, and he hugged her to his chest. "Sarah!" he exclaimed. He scarcely recognized her. Her hair was long and silky, and her cheeks were rosy, much different from the little girl he had visited just a year before. The one that looked like the end was coming up fast. He looked over and saw Sarah's mother and grandmother in the silence, smiling and waving and wiping their eyes. That was the best Christmas ever for Santa.
Did Santa's prayer really heal Sarah? Well, the so-called experts don't know much about how our minds work. Maybe by Santa telling Sarah she was going to get better, her immune system kicked in and she managed to beat the big C, as John Wayne called it. Or maybe there's a far more power in prayer than people think.
That's a really nice story. Could I make a dedication of that story?
Okay.
I would like to dedicate that story to my friend Isabel, who went to heaven this year after having leukemia. But one thing that I would always remember from her was, even to her last day, she said that you need to live with joy each day. And ever since her passing, I remember that. And for you, Isabel, up in heaven. Thank you.
1931, Ed and Julia Stewart were driving home on Christmas Eve when they suddenly had a flat tire in the middle of the Arizona desert. While her husband changed the tire, Mrs. Stewart wandered off for a bit. If you've never driven a long way across the middle of nowhere, there are a few rest areas out there. Bathrooms either. But there are bushes. As Mrs. Stewart was walking, she thought she heard the sound of crying. And this attracted her attention, so she went looking for the source. She came across an old hat box sitting in the brush. Curious, she opened it. Inside the box was a newborn baby. This all took place a few miles outside of Superior, Arizona. which was a tiny town that in 1931 was only populated by the Stuarts and a dachshund and a few neighbors. Even today, there's nothing surrounding the town but a depressing wasteland. So just think what kind of odds it took for the couple to get a flat tire in the close proximity of a discarded baby. What must have transpired to cause the couple to stop and then for Mrs. Stuart to take a walk around the brushy area on the side of the road? The Stuarts decided to hand the little girl over to the authorities so she could be legally adopted by properly vetted people, unlike some folks we know. Really, the Kent family had no legal right to keep Clark, even if he was Superman. But that was June 1938, which was 7 years after the story we're talking about. 17 couples all applied to adopt the Hatbox baby, but due to bad weather, only two of them managed to show up to the hearing. The judge ultimately granted custody to one couple who named the child Sharon. Sharon Elliott never met her biological parents, but with the support of her adopted parents, she did eventually go on to work in the aerospace industry. Which, considering that she was a woman raised in the 30s in Arizona, is also a bit of a miracle. December 1950. After the start of the Korean War, thousands of Koreans were gathering at the Hungnam docks, hoping for one of the Allied ships there to get them somewhere where they were less likely to be killed. Those jolly folks coming down from the north had a tendency to kill anyone not on their side of the war. This had a lot to do with the influence from China. When the refugees arrived at the docks, there weren't many ships left, and it didn't seem realistically possible to rescue anyone, let alone everyone. Now, thankfully, the SS Meredith Victory, a small ship stationed in Hungnam, was still in port. It was captained by Leonard LaRue, a firm believer that you shouldn't concern yourself with silly things like reality when human life is at stake. Sounds like my kind of guy. Despite the fact that the Meredith Victory was designed to hold 60 people at most, LaRue ordered all 14,000, that's 14,000, Korean refugees to board his ship. All the refugees did manage to get on board, but they were packed so tightly in the cargo hold and on the ship's deck that they couldn't even sit down. It was literally standing room only. There were no bathrooms or other luxuries available to the guests. It was December in Korea, and it gets cold over there. There was no way of heating the cargo hold or the folks standing on the deck. Food was whatever the folks had with them, and since they had been traveling to escape, they had very little of that, or water. The Meredith Victory had to navigate through a minefield. Is it a minefield if it's in the water? Well, yes, it is. I looked it up. Any bunch of mines is called a minefield. Anyway, the Meredith Victory had to make its way through all the mines that the North Koreans had dropped with absolutely no regard for people's lives. Well, that's kind of how minefields work. Had they encountered any hostile ships, the only defenses were the pistol carried by the captain. Somehow, maybe it's one of those Christmas things, the ship, filled with refugees, managed to avoid any hostile ships and wound up landing in Gyoge Island on December 25th. Not only did no one die from the lack of everything, Not only did no one die from a lack of everything, but the ship arrived with five more people on board than they had started with. five women had given birth en route to safety and freedom. You'd think someone out there in Hollywood would make this into a movie, but they're too busy remaking older movies that were just fine as they were. Oh well, that's Hollywood for you. They'll remake some movies 6 or 8 times, and yet they'll let a great story like this just sit there. Maybe Clint Eastwood will hear the story and do something with it. Anyway, and now for something a bit less serious. One day in early September, the chief of an Indian tribe, a feather, not dot, was asked by his tribal elders if the winter was going to be cold or mild. The chief asked his medicine man, but the medicine man had lost touch with how to read signs from the nature world around them, as had the chief. In truth, neither of them had any idea how to go about predicting the coming winter. So the chief decided to take a modern approach. So he called the National Weather Service and asked what the end of the year was going to look like. "It's going to be a cold winter," the meteorologist officer told the chief. Consequently, the chief went back to his tribe and he told the men to collect plenty of firewood to get them through the coming winter. A few weeks later, the chief called the Weather Service and asked for an update. "Are you still forecasting a cold winter?" he asked. "Very cold," the weather officer told him. So the chief went back to the tribe and he told his people to collect every bit of wood they could find. It looked like it was going to be a very cold winter. A few weeks later, the chief called the National Weather Service once more and he asked about the coming winter. "Oh yes," he was told, "it's going to be one of the coldest winters ever." "How can you be sure?" the chief asked. The weatherman replied, "Because the Indians of the Great Lakes area are collecting firewood like crazy." The moral of this story is nobody really knows what the weather's going to be like. They can only guess. And with that happy note, I'm going to wish everybody a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. If you enjoyed the show, let your friends know so they can enjoy it too. If you didn't like it, well, nobody wants to hear from you anyway. Anything you'd like to tell the folks at home?
Merry Christmas. Enjoy time with your family and remember what is really important. The best present that you can give is your love.
And with that, this is Chris and Lulu James for Strange Things. And I'm rolling the wrong mouse again.
Mom says a hippo would eat me up, but then teacher says a hippo is a vegetarian. There and wash him there and give him his massage. I can see me now on Christmas morning creeping down the stairs. Oh, what joy and what surprise when I open up my eyes to see a hippo hero standing there. I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. I only like hippopotamuses, and hippopotamuses like me too.